me one good reason why you need words of encouragement. I'm assuming all of you are here because you want to be entrepreneurs. Yes? No?
Yes.
But then why do you need somebody else to encourage you? It's like saying when you join an organization, you want a stupid HR manager to motivate you. How can an HR manager motivate you, right? Who motivates you? Yourself. You don't need some good person. Anyway, these kids have done a brilliant job here. The posters are officially, formally released today. So give them a big clap. I like the concept that, you know, even in a technology idea, you are emphasizing management. Because whether an idea can be implemented successfully or not, whether an idea is good or bad, really is, when do you know it? When it is executed, when it is implemented. And how do you implement it? What do you need for implementing?
Good plan.
Good plan. And then? Money. Initiative. Strategy. Most important, you left out. Passion you can take for granted, more often. You didn't become an entrepreneur without passion. Right? You know, nobody put a noose around your head and said, go become an
entrepreneur. Infrastructure.
Infrastructure. Management. All of this clubbed under one single umbrella word called management. That's what you need. And that's what the emphasis is on. So Yashasvi came and said to me yesterday that the management module we want to release in the IES, I think it's a brilliant idea, so wish you guys all the very best. Can I go back to my... Because I heard it directly from the CEO. This was was many years ago. Anybody knows who the founder of OneBible? Sam Walton? Apparently, this was just before Christmas. You know, in the US, before Christmas, sales are the maximum, right? They were hiring a lot of people in one of the flagship stores in Denver. And the HR manager was really tired because they needed to hire 75 people. And he had just finished the hiring process. He was just about to sit down when this Sardar boy walked in. And he said, I heard that you people are hiring, so can you give me a job? So the HR manager said, Nahi bacha, khatam ho gaya abhi, go jao. But the boy insisted, I've just come from India, I need the job, so give me the job. So the HR manager said, don't worry, come tomorrow, I'm sure there will be a vacancy. No, I'm making that up, he didn't say that. But I'm sure he said, you know, there will soon be a vacancy, but come on. The boy was adamant. When this tutu-meme was going on between the two of them, Sam Walton walked in. And he asked the boy, what's happening? So the boy said, you know what, I've just come from India, I need the job. Why don't you do something? Let me come tomorrow morning. I'll come whatever time you want me to come. I'll work till as long as you want me to work. At the end of the day, if you're not happy with my performance, don't pay me a cent. I have no issues with that. So maybe Sam Walton thought that there is a spark in the boy. I mean, if somebody is saying, just check me out without paying, that there is obviously something in the kid, right? So he said, okay, tomorrow 8:15, report. You have a 12-hour shift. You have to work with us till 8:15 at night. 8:15 at night next day, Walton remembered that this boy was supposed to have come. So he went in search of him. And he met the boy. And he said, so how was your day? Oh, it was okay. How many sales did you make? Oh, I made one sale. So Walton said, you know, little fellow, on a normal day, our sales executives are expected to make 35 to 40 sales. Pre-Christmas, they're expected to make 75 to 80 sales. If you have done one sale, obviously you're not good enough. So I don't think we can hire you anyway. See you. Bye-bye. He was about to walk away when something made him turn around and ask him, what was the value of the sale? And the boy said, $100,000. Now it was Walton's turn to do a double thing. $100,000? How did you manage that? Ah, you know, this customer came. He wanted to buy a small fish hook for fishing. I sold him a large fish hook. A large fish hook doesn't cost $100,000. No, I also sold him some bait. It still doesn't cost $100,000. No, I told him, now you have so much of fishing gear, why don't you go upstream? You know, where there are a lot more fish. Have fun, you know, catching more fish. And the customer said, damn neat idea, but I don't have a boat. And I said, don't worry, we have this wonderful boat. And we sell that. The customer was delighted. Then he said, after going upstream, what do you want me to do? And I said, you know what, you're going upstream, right? It leads to this beautiful wooded area, forest area. Why don't you camp the night? I will even throw in a crate of Budweiser free for you. So why don't you spend the night there? And the customer said, bloody good idea. Why didn't I think of it? So I sold him up. But what did he say? He said, I would have loved to camp the night in the forest, but I don't have camping equipment. So I said, don't worry, sir, we've got camping equipment. And I sold him the camping equipment. But it's still not $100,000. Yeah, then the customer looked at everything that he had bought and he said, oh my God, how am I going to carry all these things? And I said, don't worry, sir, we have this lovely 4x4 truck, we'll sell it. So Walton asked him, are you seriously trying to tell me that a customer came in to buy a small fish hook and you sold him large fish hook, bait, rest of the gear, a boat, camping equipment, and a truck. Is that what you're trying to tell me? And the boy said, no, Sarji. Customer came in saying he had a headache and he wanted to buy medicine for the headache. I told him, don't buy medicine. Fishing is a better way to get rid of the headache. Boy saw which 75 other people in the country. not see? Opportunity. He saw opportunity. Then what else? Did he just see opportunity? Did he just see opportunity? He created them. Bang on. He didn't just see opportunity. He created opportunity. He could have just sold the one small fish hook and have been done with it, right? He went from one to another to another to another. He created a whole gamut of opportunities for the organization. In other words, who do you think he is? Who does that? He's the entrepreneur who does that. Absolutely. Why such diffident, low voices? Uthake bolo na. Who does that? Who takes the trouble to not only see opportunity but to create opportunity? It's the entrepreneur who does that, right? And it's a bloody good time to be an entrepreneur now, because all around you, all you are seeing is hordes and hordes and hordes of opportunities. So why would you not want to grab them? Why would you not want to create more such opportunities so that you can all build a very, very vibrant entrepreneurial India? That's the whole point, right? Is there any other point? Why would you want to join a Microsoft? Why don't you create your own Microsoft? What stops you? What has created these opportunities today? What has created these opportunities today? Is one of the drivers, but broadly what has created?
Different ideas. Different ideas.
Broadly, what's the one name?
Innovation.
Broadly, what's the one name?
You.
One name? You're all thinking jargon. One name which we use day in and day out and day in and day out. What's the one word? What's created?
The educated youth.
What's happening in the marketplace? Don't use jargons. Think common sense. What's happening in the marketplace? Is the world the same today that it was yesterday? Change is what is happening today. In 3rd century BC, a Greek philosopher called Pericles apparently thought that in 3rd century BC, he thought that the pace of change was so much, he made a statement. He said, you can't step into the same river twice. By the time you take your foot out once and put your foot in again, water has flowed. That's the pace of change, he said. He had a disciple called Cleon who went one step further. He was thoda sa shana tha. So he went one step further and he said, you can't even step into the same river once. Why? By the time you have thought of it and you actually put your foot in water, water has already flowed. Imagine what they both would have said if they saw society today, if they saw India today. You understand? What's caused this change? Somebody said technology. What else has caused the change? Let's look at each one of them. Technology. You're all geeks, right? I don't need to tell you how technology has changed your life and the life around you, right? How many of you are cricket fans here?
All of them.
Not very many, right? Right? Assam, not cricket fan? How many of you watched last time's World Cup when India did so well?
So well.
What was unique? What site do you access when you want scores? So what was unique about Cricinfo during the World Cup? Do you remember you saw real-time animated figures? What made that possible? It was real-time. If Sachin hit a duck or a 200, you saw it real-time on Cricinfo. Right? What made that possible?
Technology.
Technology. As simple as that. How many of you don't have a mobile now? See, that answers my question. 10 years ago, we didn't have mobiles, right?
Yes.
A student of mine once told me, ma'am, this is the mobile generation. We may go out of our hostel without underclothes, but we won't go out without mobiles.
Exactly.
I think that pretty much is true. crisis. What made all that possible? Mobile technology.
Technology.
What about market shift? Let me ask you this. Which company invented the radio?
Murphy.
The company invented the radio. First commercial radio.
Motorola?
Radio? I don't mean walkie-talkie radio. I mean radio.
Murphy?
No.
Murphy?
No. You got the country right.
Sony.
Sony, absolutely. The first radio was invented by Sony. The world's first transistor was invented by Sony. The world's first Walkman was invented by
Sony.
So why didn't Sony invent the iPod? Complacency, absolutely. Because Sony thought, who will listen to digital format? Who will listen to MP3 format? It's just a passing fad. And finally, who went laughing to the bank?
Apple.
A company which wasn't even in that space, called Apple. Which wasn't even in the electronic space, in that sense of the term. Yeah? Market shift is happening. Consumers are asking for different things. I mean, it's unbelievable the kind of things the consumers want today. So there is a huge shift in the way we do things that is happening. And if you are not glued to it, you really have a serious problem. But that is throwing up opportunities. Globalization. Globalization. How many of you have traveled abroad? Don't you recognize a lot of brands outside? 20 years ago, if you traveled outside, you would recognize not a single brand. I could guarantee you that. But today, pretty much all the brands are all over the world. How did they happen? What is this phenomenon called globalization?
The world coming
to opening the markets. What did governments do before globalization?
They didn't let the foreign companies.
They had trade restrictions, protectionist policies. They did not allow labor capital to move freely. With globalization, labor capital is moving freely. So pretty much you're able. I mean, I don't know what is your main road. What is your market area called here?
GS Road.
Whatever is your main market, I'm sure that there is no big difference between that and, let's say, a place in Bangalore or a place in London. Because you're pretty much, do you have McDonald's here?
No.
That's so sad. Do you have KFC?
No.
Yeah. Yeah, zindagi ji rahe. So sad. Assam may be an exception, but in the rest of the world, you're pretty much able to recognize most of the brands. Because globalization. But one important thing in globalization that is happening is, 10 years ago, America used to have the arrogance that if it sells in America, it will sell in any other part of the world. Is that a fact today?
No.
So what is happening? More localization is happening. So you have a Mac which gives you Mac Alu Tiki, a paneer wrap, which I promise you don't get in any other part of the world. KFC gives you wedge fingers, which you don't get in any other part of the world. MTV, when MTV first came outside of America, the arrogance was that all youth are the same, irrespective of which part of the world they are in. And when they went to Europe first, the first thing they realized was European youth had different tastes in music. It took them 5 years to realize that. Then they came to Asia. It took them 5 more years of bleeding to realize that Asian youth had a different taste in music. So what did they do? They customized it. They localized it. Content was localized. So you had vernacular content. Am I right? It's interesting when you look at MTV. If you're just, you know, surfing the channel, even without seeing the MTV logo, you know it is MTV. They've kept the format the same across the world, but they've changed the content. It's become very important because without localized content, you really can't make much headway in the market. I don't know how many of you know this. Any of you from Bombay here? On Church Gate, from Sukh Sagar, you know, down to New Yorker and all of that, their entire stretch is vegetarian, because a lot of Gujaratis stay there. Every single outlet there, food outlet there, is vegetarian. When Pizza Hut wanted to open, you know, an outlet there, Pizza Hut was told categorically that you have to keep it vegetarian. Do you think Pizza Hut did?
They would have. They would have.
If they did, they were stupid. Right?
Yeah.
Why would they? It's the only vegetarian outlet in the world. That's the extent of customization, localization that you see happening today. So it's not, when you talk of globalization, it's not that yahan se utha waha dal, no longer that. Utha rahe ho, but you're also customizing it. You're also adding local flavor to it so that local people buy into it. What else is happening? Government policies are changing. Liberalization has happened. Without liberalization, your mobile telephony would not have happened. Even your landline telephony would not have happened, because earlier who controlled it? And you had to wait 5 years for a connection. Will you wait 5 minutes for your SIM card activated? Maa baap gaali dete ho na, if the guy doesn't activate it immediately. No. That's the extent of change. Why? Because government policies have changed. You understand that? It becomes extremely important. I've put a lot of question marks there because going forward, I don't know what else will be the drivers of change. I'm sure there will be newer and newer things that will come up, which will, you know, drive this kind of a change. Competition. I don't have to tell you what competition does. Right? Earlier, when you used to have protectionist policies, there was no competition. Today, anybody can compete with anybody in your own backyard, right? There is one very beautiful case study, you know. Procter & Gamble, all of you know Procter & Gamble. The product that they make called Pampers. Pampers is actually a brand name, but it's created a category now. When Pampers entered Japan, within 3 months, they managed to garner about 80% of the market share. Everything was going hunky-dory. But there was a local player called Kao, K-A-O. He very badly wanted to enter because it was his own country, right? He didn't want some foreigner coming and taking away the market. He wanted to enter the Pampers market. But he was very scared because he didn't have the muscle that P&G has, money muscle, market muscle that P&G has. So what do you think he did? If you were in Kao's shoes, what would you do? One, you could have partnered. Two, if you had the taqat, you could have bought Procter & Gamble.
No.
Three, what else could you have done? Go talk to the people who are buying Pampers and ask them, are you happy with the product? See, the one big difference between Japan and America is the Japs will never enter a market without adequate homework. Americans will never do homework because they are the Arabs. That's the big difference between the two, right? The Japs will never enter a market unless they have factored every single googly there. They will not enter the market. So the best thing Kao thought to do is go ask the customers of Pampers, are you happy with the product? Everybody said, bloody neat product. Damn good idea. But they insisted still. Are you happy with everything? Yeah, it's damn neat. You know, thank God, now that we have Pampers, we don't have to keep, you know, a wet belly bottom anymore. It's so good. Somebody said, but. There was a small but. Kao Lakshmi. What was the but? The but was, a number of mothers said, you know what, it's damn nice, it absorbs well, all that is fine. But it's very thick, it's very fat. So when you put it on the baby's bottom, and you put a chaddi on top of it, the baby's bottom looks huge. Read it here. If only it was a slim, trim diaper, it would be so wonderful. What do you think Kao did? Went back to the drawing board. Called its product Slim Trim, launched it in the market, within 1.5 months, garnered 60% market share. Procter & Gamble didn't know what it did. Completely decimated in the market. So what do you think P&G did now? One, P&G could have bought Kao. Two,
JV.
P&G went back to the drawing board. They also launched Slim Trim. I don't remember what the brand name is, but they also launched something like a Slim Trim in the market. They finally, in the next 3 months, dynamics of market changed a little bit. So between the two of them, they managed to have about 40-45% market share each. Was that the end of the story? No. What did P&G then do? Marketed the same product rest of the world. It took it even back to America. So today you have 80% of the global market share in P&G's hands. That's what competition does to you. Who benefited in all of this?
Consumers.
P&G didn't benefit. P&G of course benefited. They better benefit. There's no reason for them not to benefit. But who benefited the most? Right? So the next question you may ask me is, all right, change is happening around us. All right, lot of factors are driving this change, but why the hell should I become an entrepreneur? What's the reason? It's so much more comfortable finishing my engineering, maybe do higher studies, or, you know, whatever placement happens here, take up a job, live a comfortable, non-worrisome life. Do teen saal kaam karo, shaadi kar lo, bacha paida karo. Life is over. Is that what you want to do? Are you talking to yourself? Are you talking to yourself? Yeah? And what are your excuses? Why you don't want to be an entrepreneur today? These are all excuses I've heard very often from entrepreneurs. I'm too young. I'm only 22. I've just finished my engineering. I don't even know what an organization looks like. I've never worked in one. How will I build a successful organization? Sawal hi paida nahi hota. I'm a woman. Who will give me money? Yeah, women, nobody gives money. Somebody gives you money, shaadi karke nikal jao, but they are paisa. So how will I manage if I'm a woman? How will I manage? I don't have capital. Who's going to fund me? I come from a middle class family. I don't have any resources. I can't bootstrap. I can't manage. My parents have invested so much in me. I've taken a loan to complete my engineering. I need to repay the loan. If I'm an entrepreneur, I may never be able to repay the loan. So how am I going to manage? Any more excuses? I'm not from a business family. I'm a typical tamram, middle class tamram. My father says, go be a banker. Nothing more, nothing less. So how do I be an entrepreneur? Any more excuses? Come up with all the excuses. The answer is to this question that you people ask, I don't have any experience in an organization. I don't know how to build an organization. The best answer to that is incubator. You may be young and therefore do not have the experience, but it's the job of the incubator to give you three things. One, infrastructure. Two, mentorship. That's a very critical component of the incubator. You don't have network, right? To build a business, you need network. Good thing is to have a network of mentors who in turn can help you leverage their network. It's a very, very critical process. So one, you need infrastructure. That's the easiest part. College has to give you some workstations, you know, with internet facility. That's the most simple part. The hardest part is creating a mentorship network. Mentors should be both from your faculty as well as from the industry. Faculty should take on the responsibility of mentoring you guys. No incubator succeeds if faculty say, main kyun karu? 6 baje ke baad main kyun karu? Zyada paisa milega kya? If your faculty says that, then it can't be a good incubator. So you need faculty members who are good, you know, who are good mentors for you, who in turn will be able to create from the industry a mentorship process. I would also urge Barua Saab, as part of the Entrepreneurship Development Center, that you offer a course in entrepreneurship. Last evening we were talking to a number of students here, and some of the things when we were discussing, a couple of them said, ma'am, but how do we know all these things? Who will tell us about all these things? And I said, what you need is a course, you know, a quick course in entrepreneurship. And I've already spoken to Barua Saab and I've said, we can offer you a 30-hour course in entrepreneurship. Okay? It's completely optional if you want to take it, if the college is interested in offering to you. I don't mind designing the curriculum. Some of us will come and, you know, spend time with you. We've no problems. We can do that. Okay? Because we are all passionate. I mean, we all come, you know, all the way from Bangalore. Because we're passionate about building an entrepreneurial economy. Please understand. Okay? So we've got no problem, Barua Saab. You come back to us and we will set up we will design a curriculum for you to give you not a classroom lecture in entrepreneurship but a real-time feel for entrepreneurship. We'll get entrepreneurs who can come and share their journeys with you. We'll get somebody to come and talk to you about how to prepare the financials. You're all engineering students. You don't know how to prepare financials. Am I right? How many of you know to read a balance sheet? Half hand as well. One big hand as well. That's one more hand as well. So in a class of 16, if there are two people who are saying they know to read balance sheet, and they are saying it, I haven't validated it. Right? So you can imagine what we are talking about here. So who bridges the gap, you know, between your inexperience and building a successful business? It's the incubator that has to bridge it. And the third important component of the incubator is pre-seed capital. No funding agency on earth will give you money to develop a prototype. Nobody will. Everybody talks about it. Nobody does. When you go to ask for paisa, they'll say, prototype develop kar do. First three customers acquire kar do. Uske baad dekhenge. Uske baad uska kya zarurat hai? After you've got your first three customers, why do you need it? You understand, but that's unfortunately the ecosystem here. Nobody funds you. Who has to fund you? College has to fund you. How will college fund you? Maybe college can look at sponsorship. Maybe college can leverage a lot of government grants that are available. Believe you me, there are any number of government grants. DSP itself is sitting pretty on loads of government grants. And not necessarily only in technology. You want to start a small restaurant, there should be money. We should be able to incubate you here. Why this emphasis on technology? I was arguing with Barua Saab in the morning. So why are you doing only technology? Why do we want only technology entrepreneurs? No, not at all. Somebody wants to start a music school. Why not? You understand? Somebody wants to open a vegetable tailor. Why not? Person is not an entrepreneur? He is, right? So, whatever the idea, the incubator should be able to support that. Incubator should give you infrastructure, incubator should give you some pre-seed capital, and incubator should create that mentorship process for you. Why is all this important? Why am I talking so passionately about it? Because if you guys don't do it, India won't become this happening destination. Many of you must be reading in newspapers that India is looked upon as this hot destination. Am I right? India is an Asian tiger and all we keep hearing. It's a very mild billy right now. And it will remain a billy if all of you choose to look, you know, for job placements. If all of you look at opportunities in joining companies as employees. When will it become a roaring tiger? Only when every one of you here says, no, I don't want placements. I want to use the incubator that the college has created. I want to start my own business. And I want to build a vibrant entrepreneurial economy. Unless every one of you decides to do that, there is no way India is going to become this happening destination. Okay? So it's absolutely mission critical for India's economic development. Please keep that in mind. Alright?
I have a doubt that the education sector in our college is thinking on the lines that students should invest 50% of the total investment going into the total investment.
Students should invest, bootstrap,
yeah,
part of the money.
Yeah.
If they can bootstrap 50%, then they don't need the incubator, no?
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
A typical incubator operates on two models. IIM Bangalore, for instance, gives money, but takes a stake in the company. Okay, whatever, however they value it. The incubators that I have set up in engineering colleges, we give it as loan, as a debt model. My logic is equity is expensive for you, right? It's your blood and sweat. Why would you want to give it away? Even to your own incubator, why would you want to give it away? We'll give it to you as loan. At the end of the 2-year period, when we kick you out of the incubator, you return the money with some interest to us. It's not that we want to take that money away, but it will go into the corpus. So the next round of entrepreneurs can be funded from that. That's the way it should be, a moving fund in that sense of the term. No incubator asks that the entrepreneur invest in it. The reason you need an incubator is, aap sab entrepreneurs kangal hai. That's taken for granted. How many of you have baap ka paisa here? Not one hand is going up. That answers your question.
Yeah? Actually, I saw the rough draft or our information center. So that's why
आप लोग कन्विंस करो ना. बरुआ साहब को नहीं कन्विंस कर सकते तो मार्केट को क्या कन्विंस करोगे. इट्स वेर इट्स आई स्पेंड 20 इयर्स आउटसाइड. लता स्पेंड 7, 8, 10 इयर्स. वी ऑल कम बैक टू इंडिया. व्हाई? नॉट बिकॉज़ वी गॉट ओल्ड. Yes, I have gotten old, but that's not the reason why we've come back. We've come back because this is the best time to be an Indian in India. The kind of opportunities you're seeing in India, you're not seeing in any other part of the world. When people tell me they want to go outside, I laugh at them. They pagal kutta ne kaha. Why would you want to leave land of opportunity like India today and go chasing a mirage outside? जो करना है यहाँ करके दिखाओ ना. That's the whole point. India is the best place to be in. It's the best time to be an Indian. It's the best bloody time to be an Indian entrepreneur. I'm so jealous of you guys because you have this opportunity to become entrepreneurs today, to change India's destiny tomorrow. I don't have that opportunity. But the way I look at it is, if more of you become entrepreneurs, then I can always say, I taught them entrepreneurship, that's why they became entrepreneurs. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am, for such an interactive session. I'm sure it cleared many clouds of queries for most of us sitting here. Next, we have the display of the Touch Magic interactive floor in Lecture Theatre 3 in 5 minutes. So I request all of you to proceed to Lecture Theatre 3.